said, when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, that you will receive power. And at that moment, you will be witnesses of me to Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And that's really what this is all about. Like, I could preach until I'm blue in the face and you guys could all start going to youth group. But that's not going to do anybody any good if we're all hidden. I don't want you guys to leave here just being the same weak, pathetic youth group kids we all got annoyed with in high school. We know those kids that are like, they don't talk about Jesus at all until they're about to have a Super Bowl party at their church, and then they're like, hey, come to my church, it's about to be pizza and wings, and people come for pizza and wings,
yeah.
And the power of the living God could be there, and nobody would think it was a big deal.
Yeah.
And that's wrong, man. We're supposed to see the sick recover. We're supposed to be able to lay hands on the sick and see them recover, and lay hands on the dead and see them come back to life again. We're supposed to be so in tune with God that we could be walking down the street and God would say, that guy in a blue shirt, his name is James, he's going to kill himself if you don't preach Jesus to him right now.
It's a pleasure to have from Face Down Records, Mattie Montgomery, and he's going to share about his testimony and just a powerful, powerful ministry that I see developing with him. And I know you probably get this asked a lot, just, you know, share your testimony and how you, this ministry and what your vision, how it evolved. And
okay. I grew up in the church. When I was 8 years old, my father died of cancer. And at that point, I really struggled with, like, rage and anger, and I was always on edge, you know, and if anything didn't go my way, I was the first one to be, like, fighting and breaking things and throwing things. And you know, still kind of going to church just out of my mom's habit or out of, like, social obligation than any, like, real passion. And my mom went to the youth pastor and said, Mattie really needs like a spiritual father. He really needs a man in his life being, like, a positive godly influence. And the youth pastor told my mom that I had too many character flaws to do anything with, and that he would rather spend his time on kids that would be worth the energy or the investment. And so then my mom went to the head pastor and wound up talking to his wife about it. And the head pastor's wife said, you act like just because we're Christians, we're supposed to do this stuff. And so we just kind of got pushed aside, you know? And I just continued in rage and continued living my life out of this lie that the enemy had planted in me that I'd been abandoned and that I'd been failed by my father and by God and by everybody that was supposed to be taking care of me because I was so broken because of my father having died. And then, you know, that kind of shifted when I was about 15 or 16 from me needing to fight to prove my worth to me needing to get girls to prove my worth. And it was still the same brokenness. It was still the same lie. It was still the same insecurity. But, you know, it started manifesting itself sexually through, you know, me being the guy at parties that wouldn't drink, not because I had a problem with drinking, but because if I was sober and the girls were drunk, I'd have an easier time having sex with them. And that was the life that I was living for a long time. People kind of always ask me, when did you get saved? Or, like, how did you get saved? And, you know, there's, like, a number of events that I think gave me new revelation and insight into the heart of God and his plan for me. But in reality, I couldn't really tell you. I probably would have told you most of my life that I was saved. And I really wasn't. And I had no understanding of who God was. And I was fully living my life out of selfish ambition. And so, you know, there were a number of events. I think the most significant of which was the first time that I ever heard the voice of God. You know, I like, heard scripture that convicted me. But there was a time when my friend and I had been sort of jokingly considering quitting our jobs and putting all of our possessions in our car and just hitchhiking around the country for a month. And that's such a stupid idea, but for some reason there was this crazy sense of, like, destiny over it. Like, I really felt like I needed to do it and, like, it was going to change my life. But it became evident that my friend was not going to be able to go with me. And that really freaked me out, and I found myself just riding my bike around my college campus. Later that night, I was just on my face in tears in the middle of the soccer field at my school, just weeping, saying, God, I don't know who you are or where you are or if you can even hear me or if you care, but if you do, I need you to tell me what to do because I don't know. For the first time in my life, I have no idea what to do. And then later that night, I was reading a book, and the book said, now is the time to wander into homelessness and leading a holy man's life to seek the path of enlightenment. And that was the first time that the God of the universe had ever spoken to me, at least that I was like consciously aware of, and it freaked me out. And that changed everything, because it was no longer like some sort of like hero figure from a storybook that I read when I was a kid, but he was like a real God who's alive and above that is powerful and is interested in my life. So I went, and that entire month I was in a position where I was constantly at the mercy of God. I didn't have, you know, I didn't have like a phone or money or any resources that could have possibly helped me out in any of these situations. And every time something would happen, something miraculous would happen, and God would provide. And I feel like that was like my wilderness experience, like when Jacob wrestled with God in the desert and had his name changed to Israel, or even when like Jesus, after being baptized, was led out into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Like, that was my wilderness experience, where I found my identity, and I came back and didn't know what to do with it, and I was a completely different person. I had walked with God and talked with God all day every day for a month, you know, and I had seen miracles, and I had been in a place where he was really providing for me, but nothing changed. I just didn't know what to do, and I came back and wound up back in bed with girls again, and back drinking at parties again, and nothing about my life changed. And at that point, by the grace of God, I wound up getting kicked out of that college. Then I wound up going to another college, and ultimately getting kicked out of that college. I was working out one day, and I started praying, and I was like, God, was there a reason that you took me out for a month? Like, is there a reason that you did miracles to provide for me and show yourself to me? Like, weren't you supposed to do something with me? And he said, I can't give you a great responsibility until you're man enough to handle it. And so from that point, I was like, forget everything. I'm going to be in scripture every day. I'm going to be in prayer every day. I'm going to start weeding sin out of my life. I'm going to go grab anybody that claims to know God, and I'm going to make them tell me everything they know about him, you know, and I just want to know everything there is to know. And at that point, I was playing in a band out of Michigan called Besieged, and the closer I got to God, the more I felt unsatisfied with that band. And then I was going to join a band from Indiana who is actually still around and are amazing. They're called The Burial. And I for sure would have joined that band had I tried out, because those guys are great musicians and good friends of mine. And I was going to try out, and my car broke down. And then the next day, a friend of mine called and said, hey, this band for today from Iowa, their vocalist just quit. So I kind of prayed about it. And at my last show with Besieged, I was going to hitchhike from Michigan to Iowa. And this girl came up to me and said, I feel like God is telling me to give you $200. And I took that, and the next morning used that to buy a bus ticket to Iowa to join For Today. And it's been the first practice with For Today, we spent more time praying and studying scripture than we did playing music. And that kind of set the standard for what this band would be.
Seen us before, and even for those of you that have seen us before, you need to know something. And I feel like bands throw around the title Christian a lot, and bands drop the name of Jesus from stage a lot. Hold on.
We played a show in New York a couple days ago, and there was a 15-year-old girl that snuck backstage somehow, and someone that was at the show, not anyone on the tour, tried to rape her. And this girl just kind of ran out of the back room crying, and we heard what had happened, and my wife went and found her and just kind of shared the gospel with her, and was able to pray with this girl for just restoration, that any brokenness that had come through this event, or even she told my wife that she'd actually been raped a couple months earlier, and my wife was able to just pray for her for like restoration. And that girl actually texted my wife later that night and said, you completely changed my life.
Every single man standing on this stage will go to our grave swearing that that man called Jesus of Nazareth, that they put to death in Jerusalem, is alive, he's alive, he's alive, and he still changes lives today. We don't worship some theological concept. We don't worship a book. We don't worship a religion. We follow a king. His name is Jesus, and he's alive, and he's able to save. And so when we see pictures of that man just broken, beaten, and bloody, hanging on that cross with the crown of thorns on his head and the stripes on his back, man, you better believe that that's not how he looks right now. You better believe that that's not how he's going to look the next time you see him, regardless of what you believe. And so, I come here to say that Jesus Christ himself walked into hell and he walked into death and he broke the chains and he came back to life again for anybody. For anybody in this place that's sick and tired of being harassed by hell, sick and tired of being harassed by death and corruption and decay, the resurrection of Christ signifies that I don't have to live in death anymore because my King didn't put up with it. So we come to this place not looking for perfect people. We come to this place looking for people that are sick of hell in their life, who are sick of death in their life, who are looking for hope. And I believe with everything in me that there was hope in one man, the one man that was able to beat the grave once and for all, our King called Jesus the Christ.
These kids here are by and large abandoned by the rest of the world. And while this is like the backyard of the church, it seems like this is a mission field that often gets overlooked. And so, instead of God sending more qualified people, he had to send us. He took a couple drug dealers and porn addicts and drug addicts and stuck together a Christian band and sent them out into this scene, which, to be completely honest, he shouldn't have had to do. Someone should have come and preached the gospel to me at a show when I was 16 and nobody did. So God had to come and reach me through some miraculous encounter and turn me into the man that I needed to be to reach these kids because the church wasn't doing it.
God has just blessed me in a way with people he's brought into my life, and this started just as a way to give my son a better opportunity, more positive music. And I had the pleasure of meeting Bill Link from WXGN at the Shore, and you know, and recently sometimes I find more opposition coming from the church than he wanted to bring Aaron Gillespie in to do an event in his area. And some of the responses from the church just hurt, where it was the wrong element, the wrong crowd we don't want to bring to our church. And it was just like, especially, you know, who did Jesus preach to?
Right.
Who listened to him? The prostitutes and the tax collectors.
Yeah.
How is the church in your eyes, and I'll maybe let Bill share too, and ask some questions of misunderstood this generation, and how can the church learn, if they're not really familiar with the hardcore crowd or scene, be better equipped to reach out as far as ministry?
You don't have to be equipped to reach out to these kids. You have to be real and honest, you know? I feel like people look at me and they're like, well, you have tattoos and, you know, you like play their kind of music and you've been around, so you go reach them. And it's like, man, like this last thing this scene needs is more people that look like them. You know, more people that just fit in and are normal and aren't any different. I think it would raise more questions if there were like men and women, like fathers and mothers that would come to this scene and be like, listen, I love you because you were made in the image of God and for no other reason. You don't have to do anything or say anything or look like me or talk or think or act like me for me to love you, and I love you unconditionally, and to just like be the hands and feet of Jesus to these kids. I feel like this is something I was thinking while you were talking. I feel like we in the scene, though, especially believers in this music scene, have a tendency to demand of the church that they come to where we are. And the reality is that that's not any more like biblical, or that's not any more in line with the heart of God than us demanding that the kids in the scene start going to church, you know? And I see like a tendency and like a kind of alarming trend happening within believers in our scene that people are just starting their own churches and their own groups and are neglecting fellowship with anybody that doesn't think and dress and act the way that they do. And that's a really scary thing, because then we wind up taking scene politics and intertwining those with kingdom principle and saying that that's the will of God. And so we wind up making like an us and them thing within the church. Mm-hmm. And we have to like stay away from that. We have to flee from that.
So basically what the church is really doing to you right now, I mean, a lot is part of the church saying, well, you guys, you're invalid because you're not conformed to what we think the church is.
Right.
So you're saying that's going on within your scene.
Absolutely.
Is duplicating that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like we're trying to punish them for doing it to us, so we're doing it back to them.
Yeah, it's a vicious cycle.
Absolutely. And we have to end it.
But, getting back to what Jim was saying, I mean, that there is, though, I mean, how do you deal with the church that does attack you? Mm. I mean, I hate to say it in those terms, but they are.
Yeah.
I mean, saying that you're invalid in what you do, that, your whole thing is just wrong.
Yeah.
And
that's a good question. This is actually something that I had to deal with. It's really easy for me to preach and prophesy on stage when everybody in the room thinks it's awesome. And then when somebody's like, that's a lie, what you just said is totally bogus and off the wall, you're a wolf in sheep's clothing, you know, whatever. When people start throwing accusations at me, I have to really come to a realization of the true foundation of my ministry. And there was a time actually when one of the bands that we were on tour with would go on after us every night and then would specifically call out things that I said about Jesus and would be like, that's not true, he's just forcing his beliefs down your throat, don't listen to anything he says. And I got really mad and wanted to, confront him about it. And my wife, praise the Lord, my wife stopped me. And so I started like searching within myself and I was like, God, I'm mad because he's attacking the gospel. Because he's like snatching up seeds that are being planted and I need to go stop that for the sake of these kids. And then God said to me, as clear as day, he said, I don't need you to defend me. And it suddenly like clicked in me that the reason I was getting so upset was not because he was attacking the gospel, but because he was attacking me. The reason that I was ministering was not for the sake of the gospel, it was for my own sake. And I was ministering out of insecurity, and I was ministering because people expected that that's what I would do because I'm Mattie from Fort Today, because people respected it and people admired it. And so I did it because it made me look cool, to be honest. And the Lord said, if you're ministering for any other reason than that I told you to, you're doing it for the wrong reason. And so my job is to preach the gospel, period. Beyond that, if all the kids in the room are on their faces in repentance, giving their lives to Jesus, awesome, praise God. If all the kids in the room throw rocks at us and cuss at us and don't care and everybody leaves hating me and hating Christians, awesome, praise the Lord. He called me to plant the seed of the gospel. And scripture says, neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but it's God who gives the increase. So to kind of address churches that have a problem with it, I think it's wrong. I don't think that anybody's ministry should be founded or should even practice segregation from other legitimate ministries. I also don't think pointing fingers at a ministry is in itself a ministry. You know what I mean? So for churches to say we don't want that, it brings in a crowd that we don't want, is essentially for the church to say we don't want the lost. And that's a scary thing, because Jesus does. And if Jesus and his bride aren't sharing the same heart and the same vision, there's something really wrong. But I also know this, God is not going to allow these kids to get left behind. And whether he has to get some drug dealers and like perverts and change our lives and send us to preach the gospel, like he will, you know, but he shouldn't have to. He shouldn't be so low in resources to reach the scene that he has to get people off the streets to do it. The church should be like out here reaching these kids every day. To kind of address more directly, anybody that doesn't agree with this kind of music, you don't have to like it. You'll never catch me listening to this kind of music on my own time. You don't have to like it, but you have to love people, regardless of what genre of music they listen to or what kind of clothes they wear, whether they smoke or don't smoke or do drugs or don't do drugs or fornicate or don't fornicate. You have to love them because they're made in the image of God, period. And an opportunity to love these kids will never go unnoticed. And if I feel like if the church misses opportunities to love these kids because they're afraid that these kids are going to be a bad influence on their church, or they're going to bring something that's going to negatively affect the church, I think that the church needs a revelation of the authority that God has really given them, and that outside influences don't influence us, we influence them.
How many of you, you guys may not all know what I'm talking about or whatever, but even if you do know what I'm talking about or if you don't know what I'm talking about, how many of you have never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Are you willing to raise your hands? Three of you have never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Turn around.
Oh, hey, okay, all right. Sick. Good, here, you guys gather in the middle.
What we have to do is, one, be in prayer, like be in, you know, be in a position of like offensive prayer to just advance the kingdom, and just be asking God to rend and remove and purify whatever he needs to within us to make us the most accurate and radical reflection of Jesus Christ that we can possibly be.
I know for a fact that there are people here that came to the show out of curiosity and that are standing on this corner out of curiosity that need a fresh touch from God. That something significant happened in a moment in your life, and that was good enough to carry you for a couple months, maybe a couple years, but where you stand right now is nowhere near where you used to stand. The way you burn right now is nowhere near the way you used to burn. And if that's you, would you be bold enough to raise your hand?
And then also we have to be bold. Scripture says the righteous are as bold as lions, and that we're not going to sit in a building on Sundays and Wednesdays and wonder why revival is not happening in our city. We're going to be out in the streets, we're going to be out in gas stations and at Walmart, we're going to be talking to strangers, and we're going to be unable to remain silent about the hope that we found in Jesus.
Listen to me, this is not a one-time event. I don't want you to live the next 10 years of your life talking about what happened tonight. Yeah. I want you to live the next 10 years of your life talking about what Jesus is doing that day. You need to understand that every moment God is speaking, whether you're listening or not, and the qualifier for you as to whether you're going to be positioned to speak the word of God, whether you're going to be a generation that prophesies to the nations and sees the sick healed and the broken restored, is going to be whether or not you're willing to listen in every moment, to turn your attention and your affections away from worthless, worldly things. So listen, friend, you can come up here and pray all you want. You can raise your hand and be honest about it all you want. You can talk about this moment all you want, but it's going to be what you do with every moment after this. Every moment from this point on, it's going to be what you do with that decides whether or not you're qualified to be a part of this movement. So listen, I'm just going to pray for everybody here that needs to be touched by God, whether it's the first time, whether it's the 100th time. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Pastors, youth pastors, or churches, how do they go about booking you for a speaking engagement with a youth group or maybe in front of the church?
You could book, you can email booking@mattiemontgomery.com, or you can just go to my website, and there's a contact form that people can fill out. Okay. If they're interested.
I appreciate just for your time and having the opportunity, and hopefully this video will inspire and enlighten churches to carry. That was the whole motivation behind this interview. And cool. Thank you so much.
Hey,
so,
my pleasure. Thank you.
Right, thank you.
God, you're here. You are here, Creator, Father, Lover, Mighty Warrior, Wise Ruler, King, Commander of Glory, the Mighty One that sits on the throne, the beginning and the end. Oh, hallelujah. God, you are here. You are mighty. You are supreme. We love you, God. Thank you that you are here, Lord. God, we just repent as a family for the fact that we've ignored your presence for years. That you've been near to us, God. Your word says that the whole earth is full of your glory, and we've missed it. We've been distracted by the latest Hollywood flick. We've been distracted by the latest trend or the latest band's album. We've been distracted by boyfriends and girlfriends and worthless garbage, God. Your glory has been filling the earth for as long as we've been on it, and we've missed it, God. Awaken our senses, Father. Awaken our senses again, God. Sharpen our senses to be able to see you, God. Open our ears to be able to hear you, God. We just receive the blood of Jesus for the remission of sins over everybody here, God.
Yes, Jesus.
I declare that your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus. It is finished. It is finished. Your sin is removed from you as far as the east is from the west. It is done. Sin has no dominion over you any longer. I declare over you a fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire right now to be released. Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Holy Ghost, I declare that you will take full possession of every soul here. You will take full possession of every mind here. Holy Spirit, you take full possession of every body here. We are insufficient in and of ourselves. But with you, we are more than conquerors. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. You are the King on the throne. The only one that deserves authority in our life. So we give it all to you. Oh, God, we just rejoice that prodigals have come home tonight. We rejoice that wandering, backslidden Christians have come home tonight. They're going to stop playing church now. They're going to stop playing church now. They're going to stop playing church now. I baptize them with boldness in the name of Yeshua the King. I baptize them with boldness, God, that they would confront sin and not simply run from it. Oh, hallelujah. I declare that they will confront sin and not simply run from it, God. Oh, I just declare that Prince of Peace reigns over every life here. The Prince of Peace reigns in every life here. King, you are the King. Jesus, you are the King here. Every heart longs for you, Jesus.